Praise the Lord. Can you hear me well?
Oh, yeah.
All right. I'll try to be brief this morning. To welcome Pastor Sally. We missed you.
Amen.
Glad to have you back. So while Pastor was away, I had the opportunity to give a message on the two Wednesdays that he was gone. And I was talking about, first about what our identity is, who God says we are. So I was talking about how we're created, how we're chosen, how we're his children, how we're redeemed. Then the following week, I was talking about patience, and, you know, I was talking about how the more we dig into God's word, the more it's embedded in our hearts, and the more patient we become when we're waiting for something. So when I was asking him about what should I speak about today, I don't remember if it was on Friday or yesterday, but he really embedded this in my heart. And I'm going to read to you from Psalms chapter 34. I'm going to read the whole chapter, but then I'll tell you which verse he actually impressed upon me. It says, "I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes it boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant, and their faces shall never be ashamed. This poor man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him have no lack. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. What man is there who desires life and lost many days, that he may see good? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Turn away from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are towards the righteous, and his ears toward their cry. The face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to cut off the memory of them from the earth. When the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is near to be broken to the brokenhearted, and saves the crushed in spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. He keeps all his bones, not one of them is broken. Affliction will slay the wicked, and those who hate the righteous will be condemned. The Lord redeems the life of his servants. None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned." When the Lord spoke to me, I started thinking about all of those that in the past few weeks have stood in front of this congregation and humbled themselves and have spoken about the things that are going on in their lives. Michael, when you talk, I thought about you. Myron, you know, when I stood here and I was talking about why I was gone for a while, because I felt in some kind of hole, and I needed to hide and withdraw. But this is what the Lord impressed on my heart. I sought the Lord, and he answered me and delivered me from all my fears.
Yes, Lord.
He wrote this in my heart this past few days, and I kept hearing it over and over. So what I want to tell you is this. When you're going down the road, and you come to a fork and you don't know what to do, sit down, pull out a chair, metaphorical or physically, and seek the Lord, because he's going to answer you and he's going to deliver you from all your fears.
Amen.
That's what David is saying in here, what he did. I have no doubt in my mind that when we do the same, that's the same thing that happens. And further down, when in verse 19 he says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all.
Amen.
Anything that you might be facing, the Lord is going to deliver you. Seek him, he's going to answer you, and he's going to deliver you from all your fears.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
It's hot in here.
Fire.
That's the Holy Spirit fire, right? All right. Pastor Sally, welcome back again.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Any prayer requests or testimonies? Yes, Myron.
Of course. I've got a testimony. As you were just saying, I just want to thank this whole body for praying. And God has answered prayer this morning. I woke up with almost zero amount of pain. I didn't
Hallelujah.
Think there was anything wrong with my back.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
And I watched the YouTube on Wednesday, the service, and for 3 years I've been studying Be Anxious for Nothing, but in prayer and supplication make your request known to God and he will direct that. Troubles, I'm sorry, I messed up. Be anxious for nothing, prayer and thanksgiving, and he will give you peace.
Amen.
And then your next verse was, trust in the Lord with all your heart. And I just about come unglued. I mean, I was unglued. and I'm just like, that was the message that, I have been trying to put together myself. And Roberto just nailed it. I know it was the Holy Spirit. I know
thank you, Lord.
And then yesterday I went to get in my vehicle. I thought, well, I haven't been in my vehicle. I haven't done Uber since I got to the hospital. And this isn't Christian music that I listened to. It was classic vinyl. And the first song that came on was, as I was pulling out, was Bob Seger, Rock and Roll. And then the next song I heard was, while I was going down the road, was The Who, Iron Free. And I know, like I said, I wasn't Christian, but I'm just like, God just touched me and he said, you are free, you are healed. And I was again, I just thank everybody here for, Sister Shelley has told me some things about diet and all that. That was the other praise report, that I lost 20 pounds.
Amazing.
So I'm going for another 20.
on the cross, but he never struggled. And as he is, so are we.
Right.
So we don't have to struggle through this life. Yes, things come, I was thinking of, you know, we wrestle the principalities and the powers or whatever, but he's already won. So I was thinking, my brothers are wrestlers and have been around it. This is Iowa. You know, if you went into the match and you knew that you already won, yes, the struggle would be inconvenient, but if you already know you've won, it's just like a matter of time or patience or whatever. So as he is, so are we. We are not struggling. The things we come across might be an inconvenience, but if we can remember who we are and just rest in that,
Sheila. Sometimes it's easier to hold on to and harbor feelings against someone, but I determined with Jayla's dad that, you know, anytime any negativity would come in, I'm just going to pray for him and just cut that cord of negativity.
Mm-hmm.
He came by on Wednesday and brought some Pampers, and I spoke to him and told him, you know, you're not a bad guy all the time. And you really need to man up, because every little girl wants to feel like she's daddy's princess. I told him some other things too. After he left, he looked really sad. You know, I was watching his demeanor as he walked by, but he texts my daughter. He says, "Your mom was right. I'm ready to man up. I'm ready to put all this crap behind me and to move forward." You know, so I just refuse to let the negativity of all the past, you know, ruin my life and cause stress in my life, and just proclaim who this man is in Christ. And he would finally identify this and step up to the plate and do what he's supposed to do. I says, you know, we really needed some other things too. And he apologized and says, "I didn't know you needed those things." You know, that's just not in his demeanor to do that kind of thing. So, you know, I just thank the Lord. No need to pray and then not give thanks. And I'm just going to continue to believe that he's going to step up to the plate.
Yes.
Be a man of his word. He started a new job, that he would find favor in this job, and and be there for his little girl.
That's right.
I mean, we're basically raising this little girl, you know. It's time for them to step up to the plate.
Yes, ma'am.
And so I'm just going to keep on cutting the cord of negativity, and every time those thoughts come of what happened, and just say, in Jesus' name, you know, I've seen him go to the altar at Jamel's church and to pray and ask the Lord into his heart, so I know that, you know, God's bigger than all of that stuff.
Amen.
My Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God.
Anyone else? Going once, twice? All right, let's stand. And let's come to the Lord this morning. Father, we thank you for bringing us here in your presence today. We thank you, Lord, for everything you do. Thank you, Lord, for all of your promises. Thank you, Father, for when we seek you. We know that you answer, Lord, and you deliver us from all of our fears. Thank you, Father, for we put our trust in you, and we know that you never fail us. Thank you, Lord, for everything that you have done for us to bring us to the world we are right now in our lives. And although we might struggle, Lord, we know that the battle has been won. You have already declared us righteous. We are your children, Father. And as your children, you protect us, Lord. And you make sure that we are taken care of. We thank you, Father, for giving us the opportunity to go out and spread your word. Speak to those that are lost, that are in seek of you. For we know that they are going to find you and see your face. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for guiding us through this path, Lord. For putting people in our lives for us to bless them and for us to be blessed by them. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us together in your name, because we know that you are here right now, moving and manifesting. And your message, Lord, will be released. Your kingdom will manifest here in this place, Father. But thank you, Lord, for giving us the boldness so that we might go out and share the good news of your gospel. Thank you, Heavenly Father. If anyone is in need of prayer right now and would like to come forward so that we might pray, you're more than welcome to do so. The Lord is here and he's listening to you and he's answering right now.
Thank you.
Bible says that where two or three are gathered in his name, that's where he is, and he is here right now.
Yes, he is.
All right. It's moving, it's moving. Do you have any, oh. All right. Announcements, please turn your cell phones off or put them on vibrate. Okay, August 12th, a week from this coming Friday, we're having our Eastern Gate. I was thinking about that this morning. If you can come, come. Wonderful things happening here. If you want to worship with us, if you want to pray, this is open. So just come and release it and be expectant.
Amen.
Praise God.
That's it.
Awesome things are happening. All right, well, let's speak the word this morning. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. And I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servants, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
I love the Lord right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for loving us. Thank you for showing us what love is, Lord. For being that personification of love. To see that, Lord, because of you, we can love like you. We can share God by sharing your love, the love of God that is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, by your Spirit, the Spirit of Christ in us, that hope of glory. We thank you today, Lord. Thank you for your love, for your goodness, for your grace. Thank you for you, Lord. We celebrate you this day and every day. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Give him a hand clap. Amen. God bless you. All may be seated. Thank you, worship team. Thank you, Mike, as always. Great job. I want to thank Tim and Suzanne and Roberto, all of them for stepping up and taking care of the services, and I appreciate they all did a great job for what we were able to pick up. I know we had a little bit of internet issues, and that lake, we're down in a hole there, so the reception isn't the greatest because it's down in a valley, like, so internet and cell phones don't work perfectly there at times. So. But what we were able to see, we were very pleased with, and I know because they've done great job in the past, they would do the same. So thanks to all of you. Good to be back. And good to be back in the house of the Lord. Praise God.
Amen.
Sunday school kids, they allow it. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. So we had a great time, and as you can see, my hair is still suffering. Lake. I didn't use any mousse. It kind of just does its own thing. Praise the Lord. But anyhow, God is good, and I would like to just say that, when we communicate with one another, it isn't always communication. In fact, sometimes it's just words. But I think it's so easy to be misunderstood and to miss. Maybe the depth of what it is we're trying to say and to do. Of course, we're all limited with our own vocabulary and the way that we present things, so by our own personality and so forth. But, I listened to some messages. Eric had given me an iPod and some messages. I listened to several of those. They were very, very interesting, very good, very true. But what I realized... without having a real in-depth, study of the messages, excuse me. But I understand what I'm seeing is that the reason for grace, obviously, is that we can't do this ourselves. We're not capable of being perfect and righteous and holy and fulfilling the demands of the law and God's righteousness on our own. So obviously we have grace that puts us in right standing with God and makes us acceptable to God, even in our imperfection and our inability to be perfect. God declares us perfect. And out of that, we realize Jesus, it's the righteousness of God in Christ that we receive. Now, it's great that we get it for free. We don't have to do anything to keep it, to maintain it. But the reason for it really is to transform us into the person of Jesus Christ or into his likeness.
Yes.
And we, as natural beings, even though we are supernatural and have been born again, we still think most of the time because our minds aren't continuously being renewed. We think in terms of, this makes us powerful, that we now have power, that we now have the ability to do things that we couldn't do before, and that's true. But the real purpose is to bring the love of God, the person of God, into our hearts, into our lives.
Amen.
And that person is love.
Yes.
Now, I understand we can be born again by the grace of God and still be hateful.
Yes.
I mean, we know that's true because we, you know, we've been in church a while. Praise the Lord. That went right past you, but I'm saying it anyhow. Hallelujah. And I'm just saying what God is wanting to do with us is to make us lovers.
Yes.
Amen.
To make us love the way Christ loves. That's the transformation that he's after. And this is just, I'm just saying this because it's on my heart right now, and so I'm not, that's not where I'm going this morning necessarily, but I'm just saying, sometimes we hear what we want to hear. You know, we hear what we're already programmed to hear. And so revelation comes, and we think we hear it, but it really doesn't become a part of us. It's just more knowledge. And the reason for every bit of revelation is to prepare us for the next revelation, to prepare us to have the mind of Christ, to be able to think in that way so that we can receive everything that God has for us, so we can be everything that God has created us to be. Now, for example, a guy calls the emergency room, and he says, give me a doctor quick. He said, my wife is going to have a baby, or she's about to have a baby, and her contractions are only like 2 minutes apart, so they put a doctor on the phone. And the doctor says, is this her first child? And he said, no, you idiot, this is her husband. So I'm just saying, we think we're communicating sometimes, but we're not hearing what the other person is saying either, so we're not picking up everything that God has for us. So the reason I'm saying, the reason I believe that grace is important, because it's the gospel. But the reason for the gospel is to recreate us, is to have us be that new creation that happens when we're born again, the results of the gospel. So to just have grace for the sake of selfishness is just foolish. I mean, we need it. We got to have it. But the reason for the grace is so that we can then operate
yes.
the way Christ operated.
Yes.
So our focus needs to be not just on the fact that we get away with a bunch of stuff, praise the Lord, but that we can impart this love that God has for us
yes.
to other people so they can see God. That's the only way they're going to see him.
Amen.
They're going to see him through love. Faith works by love. Everything works by love. So you can see, I got, you know, I don't want to, you know, just repeat a bunch of things, but I'm just saying this is what I'm seeing. What I, you know, Eric and I have talked about this before, but then I had this iPod, as I said, and I listened to several of the more recent ones, the 2016 is the ones I was focused on the most, just because they were current, you know, something that was being said right now. But it's very, very good. And it has opened my eyes and my heart to some other things, that how important grace is. Not just for the sake of grace, not just for the sake of being given a pass. And it's way more than that, and I think you understand that. But it's to bring us to a place where we can actually function as this new creature, as this new creature in Christ.
Yes.
So that love can dominate. Perfect love casts out fear. A lot of the things I heard this morning talking about, you know, sure, you get anxious. You've got a bad diagnosis. You've got a relational issue. You've got all kinds of things. And the first thing that happens is fear almost every time. Now, if we are sure of God's love, it casts out fear. What do you got to fear if you know that God's love is for you and that it's in you and that it wants to provide everything? Not just for you, but for everybody that you're in contact with. So, praise the Lord. With that said, and if any of you know what I'm talking about, say praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Okay, thank you. All right, Sheila, I've got a whole bunch of scriptures this morning. And it's because I haven't been here for a while. So I've had a lot of time. Hallelujah. And now you're going to pay for it. Praise the Lord. Just kidding, of course. But I'd like to start with Matthew chapter 16 and read verses 6 through 12. Now, I mean, I think you all know these things, but let me just say this. The knowledge of God is one thing. I mean, the devil believes and trembles. So We have to have a knowledge of God. First, you know, you must believe that he is, right? And then that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So, but knowledge in and of itself isn't enough. We need to experience God. And I'm going to tell you, the only way you really experience God is not through your healing. I've had a healing. I've been healed from hepatitis C. I get doctor's reports. Go to the VA hospital. They'll show you, amen, all the tests and everything that they did. But they were telling me I had it until I was healed. No medical. I mean, there's nothing you can take for it. It's like they give you a bunch of pills or something. You just deal with it, you know, and at some point get a liver transplant or die. Well, I was healed.
Hallelujah.
And I know that God is a healer.
Lord, yes,
but my point is this. God doesn't define himself as the healer. He is the healer, but he defines himself as love.
Yes.
Amen.
What we should experience through our healings, through our deliverance,
yes,
is God's love.
Yes.
Not a momentary, miraculous intervention, but God's continuous, perfect, unchanging love. Let me just say that if we really get this, there'll be more healings. There'll be more deliverance. There'll be more salvations. Because we don't have a mixed up, kind of distorted image of God.
Amen.
He's good all the time.
Yes.
He loves all the time.
Yes.
He wants to heal all the time. He wants to deliver all the time. He wants to save all the time. That's just the way God is. That's just who he is. He's love. And so I'm not as concerned about being a healer or having a healing ministry. I just know that'll happen. That happens. It'll happen naturally, supernaturally. So I'm not focusing on that or deliverance ministries or anything. I'm saying all that's good, but I'm saying if we make the focus it's supposed to be. In other words, make the main thing the main thing. The other things will be dealt with. That's why it says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things get added.
Yes.
Amen? So, anyhow, praise the Lord. We need experience, not knowledge. How many of you know you can go to college for 20 years and get out and be dumber than a brick when it comes to application?
Yes.
I mean, we know people that have tremendous IQs, but they're functional idiots because they can't put the thing that they know to practice. And I say, without being disrespectful, that's one of the problems with Christianity. We've got all kinds of information, but lousy application in many cases. And that's why we're all dysfunctional.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. That's good for relating, but it's not great for victory.
Come on.
Praise the Lord.
Here we go.
All right. Then said Jesus unto them, take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees. And they reasoned among themselves, saying, it is because we have taken no bread. Which when Jesus perceived, he said unto them, O ye of little faith, why reason ye among yourselves because ye have brought no bread? Do ye not yet understand, neither remember the 5 loaves, or of the 5 loaves of the 5,000, and how many baskets ye took up? Neither the 7 loaves of the 4,000, and how many baskets ye took up? How is it that you do not understand that I spake it not to you concerning bread, that you should beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees? Then understood they how that he bade them not beware of the leaven of the bread, but of the doctrine of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees. So it's basically saying what I just tried to say. They're focusing on miracles and on bread and food and needs and so on and so forth. And Jesus is saying, those are all peripheral. Those are all add-ons. The focus is, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees, which is law, God's anger, God's judgment, God's demands, right? That's what he's telling them. That's what you need to be focusing on here. Amen? Okay, so Galatians chapter 5, verses 1 through 9. I mean, I still talk to people every day that think the problems they have is because God's getting even. or that God's trying to correct them, or that God's trying to fix them, or that God's trying to draw them into something deeper. That's just not the truth. And not only does it mess up the individual, but it distorts the image of God. It perverts our vision or our ideas and our understanding of God. And therefore, believe me, what you don't understand is what you're going to communicate.
Yeah.
See if I said that right.
Yeah.
I mean, you say, we think we just, we speak out of knowledge, but the truth is we speak out of what we don't know too. And that becomes confusion.
Yes.
So if we don't know, we're not a very good witness. In fact, we're worse than a not very good witness. We're actually deceiving people. And most importantly, we're deceiving ourselves. We're singing songs about being set free. You can't free anybody if you're locked up with them.
That's right.
Anybody see Prison Break? They did, but they're the only ones. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has made us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Behold, I, Paul, say unto you that if ye be circumcised, Christ shall profit you nothing. For I testify again to every man that is circumcised that he is a debtor to the whole law. Christ has become of no effect unto you. Whosoever of you are justified by the law, you're fallen from grace. All right, now, think about this. If Christ has become of no effect unto you, whosoever of you are justified by the law, you're fallen from grace. Those are compatible terms. In other words, Christ has become of no effect unto you is the result of being justified by the law. And if you're justified by the law rather than by the grace of God, you're fallen from grace. You're no longer under grace. And we've got people who are expecting God's grace, expecting God's favor, and not experiencing it. And I'm just going to tell you, the reason people are not experiencing the grace to the degree that God has declared it available is because we're not living under grace. We have a knowledge of it, but we don't have experiential understanding because God is grace. Grace is a person just as love is a person.
Yes.
And if you're not experiencing that person, just having knowledge of that person doesn't change things. But it looks like, to the individual believer, it looks like God's withholding something from them. It isn't. There's only one way we receive, and that's by grace.
Yes.
Yes. Am I making any sense? Praise the Lord. So if you're being justified by the law, you're not in a position of grace.
That's right.
All right? For we through the Spirit wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. It's the faith of God.
Mm-hmm.
Through the Spirit, wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. For in Jesus Christ neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith which worketh by love.
There you go.
Praise God. You did run well. Who did hinder you that you should not obey the truth? This persuasion cometh not of him that calleth you. Who's calling us? It's Jesus, right? No man goes to the Father except by him. And this persuasion or this way of persuading people or convincing people is not from him.
Right.
It's from religion.
Right.
And he says, a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. A little law will screw you right out of grace.
Right.
Sorry,
exactly.
But that's the fact. See, we got to embrace God for who he is. The love of God. The goodness of God. The grace of God. They're all part of the fact that God is love. And to approach him any other way puts you back in this position where you're not going to ever really experience the fullness of God. And there's nothing worse than having knowledge of something but not experiencing it. It's called frustration. And in a lot of churches, it's called backsliding. Which is what happens when people get burned out trying to do everything that they think they're supposed to do, but incapable of doing it. And in the process, they're losing out on the positive side of that, which is the grace of God, the goodness of God for healing, deliverance, mercy, grace, so on and so forth.
Yeah.
So they get frustrated.
Right.
They say, what's the point? I can't do this. Of course you can't do it. That's why Jesus did it.
Right.
But if we're conflicted, we're thinking we're still failing, we're still screwing up, we're still losing, we're still, you know, nowhere near what God is demanding of us or expecting of us. And so we get frustrated and say, well, who can do this? Well, with man, it's impossible.
Amen.
But with God, all things are possible.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. So we look to him. He's the author and finisher of our faith. Amen? So a lot of false doctrine about the nature of God, they come from a mixed gospel. I promise you, you could go into churches anywhere, Christian churches, and find people that are living in fear. Dissatisfied, dysfunctional, frightened, because they have a perception of God that comes from a mixed gospel. Acts chapter 20 and verse 24. And I want to be free, you know, not free just for the sake of being free, but free so that I can be everything that God created me to be, so that I can experience everything that God wants me to experience. None of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy and the ministry which I have received of the Lord Jesus, to testify the gospel of the grace of God. That's Paul speaking. That's the ministry. There's all kinds of stuff you can be doing, but that's ministry.
Yes.
To testify to the gospel of the grace of God, the love of God, the goodness of God. That's our testimony. That's our witness. Amen? Galatians chapter 1, verses 6 through 8. I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. It happens. You hear grace at almost every service. In fact, I'd say every service. It may not be all about grace, but you're going to be hearing grace in the message, in every message. I don't know how you could preach the gospel and not do that,
right,
to be quite honest with you. But I also know that you can hear it and amen it and go out the door and live different. Because the enemy immediately comes to challenge whatever God gives you. Whatever the word gives to you, the enemy comes right away and tries to steal that back from you. Praise the Lord. That's why we have to hear it over and over. That's why we have to renew our minds. And that's why we have to speak these things out ourselves, because they have to be the dominant thinking and vocabulary that we use, or we lose.
Sure.
I don't want to be schizophrenic. I mean, okay, I can be paranoid, but, you know, hey, I'm not out swimming in the water, and Sally's telling me all about the horrible life forms that are underneath the water, and I'm kind of mocking her and kidding her and teasing her and stuff, because I've never had any fear of the water. I've always loved it. And about that time, a fish attacks me. Seriously. Bit me on the nip. If you're familiar with that term, it's a medical term. You may not have heard it. But, it latched on like I was a piece of bait. Or bait, depending on what part of the country you're from. I mean, it was on me. Flopping around. It's comical. Didn't break the skin or anything, but it certainly distracted me for a moment or two. Just so happens about that time, I'm off the end of the dock, and there's like a little sandbar if you go out far enough and where you can actually stand up. There's a boat that's making its turn, because where the cabin of the house is, it's in a no-wake zone, so everybody has to slow way down and make the turn to go back out. So this boat's spinning around. There's a gal in the boat. Somebody's driving. She stands up. She saw the fish. on me. And she said, did he bite you? I said, yeah, but he didn't get much. And I didn't have much to give, praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Come on.
Where was I going? So we are an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. Praise God. I'm just saying that stuff happens, you know? But we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let it be accursed. Now, I've heard people say, well, you know, you're cursed. God's going to curse you. No. You're either delivered from the curse of the law by the grace of God, or you're still subject to the curse, and that's what he's talking about. If you fall back, if you come back from withdraw from grace, you're back under the law. So you are just accursed. It isn't like he's cursing you. It's just you're either delivered from the curse of the law or you're still under it.
Right.
You still got to deal with it.
Yes.
I'll think about why I said that about being attacked by the fisher in a little bit. Maybe it'll come back to me that it'll actually make some sense. But I just wanted to share it because it was a very painful experience. I want you to know I toughed it out. I survived. A mixed gospel is any time you try to mix. See, Sally's having a great time. See, I haven't had to think for 2 weeks. It's kind of a new experience for me. I'm just easing back in. But a mixed gospel is any time where we attempt to balance law and grace, with the goal being offer enough love and acceptance to get somebody saved. And then dump all the rules on them that they have to follow in order to keep their salvation. Now, that's been the typical experience that most Christians have had. And by mixing the two covenants, religion has created a picture of God that makes him like my neighbor's dog. That most of the time they seem friendly and, you know, wagging their tail and stuff, but you never know.
Right.
He'll go for your hand. He'll bite you because he can.
Yeah.
Most of the time, he seems like a pretty decent dog, but I wouldn't get too trustful.
Right.
Or you'll be running around with, you know, missing digits. And that's kind of the impression that this mixed gospel gives us of God.
Right.
Most of the time, he's pretty good, but man, don't get on the wrong side of it. Or if he's in a bad mood today, you know, your dinner. Praise the Lord. So, it's like, he just bite you because he can. He'll just hurt you because he's all powerful and he can do that. So just like with the Galatians, fear is usually the main force behind most Christians abandoning the gospel in favor of the Jesus plus me message. It's fear. It's fear that this is too good to be true. There's got to be something I've got to be doing, or God's going to bite me. And what the problem is, what Christians usually neglect to realize is that Jesus preached an all or nothing gospel. The message that he preached was one or nothing. Amen. John, look at Matthew chapter 5, verse 20. I'm saying all this stuff, well, most of it, for a reason. Some of it just because it's in my head and I can't help myself. Oh, I know what I was saying. Paranoid. I'm not schizophrenic. See, it all comes back to me. It's just short-term memory loss. Paranoid. So I'm paranoid, but you're not, I mean, it's not paranoia if the fish are really out to get you.
Right?
Right? I mean, that's... I mean, if they're attacking, it's one thing for Sally to be paranoid. She's standing on the deck. I'm experiential. I'm in there with the thing hanging on me. That's not paranoia. Right? That's, I know. He's not big enough to eat me all at once, but it's like an elephant. You just eat it one bite at a time, you know? That's, I'm sure that's what he was thinking. This could be a month.
He's just having to move
some. That too. But I'm just saying, I'm not paranoid. Hallelujah. It's true. Praise God. Well, anyway, for I say unto you, that except your righteousness shall exceed the righteousness of the scribes and the Pharisees, you shall in no case enter into the kingdom of heaven. Well, how, you know that the law, the demands on Paul talks about, you know, Pharisee after after a Pharisee. I mean, I'm just, you know, I'm the epitome of a Pharisee. I do it all. I keep all the rules. I keep all the guy wanting to know how to be, oh, I fast twice a week. The law demanded that you fast once a year on the Day of Atonement. This guy's saying, hey, I'm fasting twice a week.
Yeah.
Twice a week. I tithe everything. Uh-huh. Not just the increase. I give tithes on all of it. Not just my net.
Uh-huh.
I tithe everything. Somebody gives me a candy bar. A tenth of it's going somewhere. I'm giving it away. Everything, you know, right? So Jesus is saying, unless you are beyond the seeming perfection of the Pharisees and the scribes, you're not getting into the kingdom because of what you do.
Right.
And let me remind you this. The kingdom is not a thing. It's not meat or drink, but it's righteousness, peace, love, joy in the Holy Spirit. It's in Christ. That's the kingdom. The kingdom is in Christ. That's why wherever we go, we take the kingdom because Christ is in us.
Yes.
The kingdom is not a geographic location, here or in heaven. The kingdom is Jesus himself.
Yes.
Because in the kingdom, everything is already accomplished.
Yes.
So if you're in Christ, you got it all.
Yes.
But you can only get into Christ, into the kingdom, one way. That's by grace.
Yes.
Come on.
Because anything else is not going to get you Jesus.
Right.
How many of you know you can't be born again by keeping the rules? Amen. All right, Romans chapter 9, verses 30 through 33. We need to settle once and for all who we are, what we are, what we've been defined as by God, and then live our lives out from that.
Amen.
What shall we say then, that the Gentiles which follow not after righteousness have attained to righteousness, even the righteousness which is of faith? But Israel, which followed after the law of righteousness, hath not attained to the law of righteousness. Why? Because the law places demands on you, but it doesn't do anything to help you accomplish it. It tells you what you got to do, but it doesn't do anything to help you do it.
Right.
It just points out your inability to do it. Right? So, wherefore, because they sought it not by faith, but as it were by the works of the law, well, they stumbled at the stumbling stone. As it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and a rock of offense, and whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. Praise the Lord. That would be the kingdom. That would be Jesus, right? All right, John chapter 14 and verse 6. Jesus said unto them, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me. So, the fact is, Christianity doesn't know anything about balance. It's one way and only one way. There isn't any balance in the gospel. There isn't all kinds of different ways to make this happen. This is the problem with universal thoughts of deity, and they're all the same. Now, they are not all the same, believe me. There's one God. And the only way to him is through the person of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
By grace.
Amen.
That upsets a lot of people, but too bad. Just get over it or learn to live with it, because that's the fact. That's the way it is. So there isn't a balance here. There isn't a, you know, a little of this, a little what you do, and a little what he did. It's all about what he's done.
Yes.
And our acceptance of that. So attempts to balance law and grace do not take into consideration the life and ministry of Jesus. Look at Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3. being in the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins and sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high, who being the brightness of his glory, the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, without any help from us, by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. Praise God. Amen. All right, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1. For the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never with those sacrifices which they offer year by year continually make the comers thereunto perfect. Law couldn't do it. No matter how many sacrifices, no matter how often, and the very fact that they had to be continuous tells you that they were limited. Amen. So they can never make you perfect. The law, the religion, will never make you perfect. No matter how focused you are on your religion. Praise God. See, there's only one room for one person on a cross.
Right.
You ever notice that? Amen. The cross doesn't have any room for company.
That's right.
And any attempt to try to temper or alter the goodness of God with wrath and justice does one thing, and that's dilute the gospel's power. This is the power of God unto salvation.
Amen.
And to put yourself up there or anybody else dilutes the truth.
That's right.
Now, I get it that under the old covenant, God may have issued justice and he dealt with sin relatively quickly. He was never personified by his anger or by his judgment, by his wrath. He was still gracious because that's who he is. He had to deal with man on the circumstances in which they find themselves, which is the law. But look at this in Psalms chapter 44, verse 3. For they got not the land in possession by their own sword. The people are trying to get an inheritance here, trying to get their reward, their power, their authority, their whatever. But look, they didn't get the land in possession, which is a metaphor for the kingdom, for having Christ and all the fullness of that. Neither did their own arm save them, but thy right hand and thine arm and the light of thy countenance, because thou hadst a favor unto them, because you showed them favor. Hallelujah. That's Old Testament. But that's our God.
Yes.
That's the one who is expressed perfectly in the person of grace, in the person of Jesus. Praise God. I know wrath and justice existed for a time, but once Jesus received in his body the full punishment for sin, God's wrath was eternally satisfied.
Yes.
Once and for all.
Yes.
1 John chapter 4, verse 16. As long as you're in the equation, your flesh, you're going to have a problem receiving the promises of God. Because I promise you, even if it wasn't for the fact that we already know that it's only through grace, you know yourself better than anybody outside of God. So you'll find plenty of reasons why he should not heal you or should not prosper you or should not give you the breakthrough, because you're a screw-up. Because you're not perfect. Right? Your own conscience will condemn you. And if it doesn't, if you're not married, go to work. Somebody will point out the flaws for you. They'll be happy to. And if they don't, the devil will. It's just the way it is. Amen? So we have known and believed the love that God hath to us. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him.
Amen.
Somebody say praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Okay, still out there. Isaiah chapter 53, verse 11. You know, over the years, God has given me a lot of different scriptures. One I've talked about before, when we took the church and had the financial kind of situation that we were going to be faced with. And the Lord said if I just trusted him, that he would be my shield and my exceeding great reward. Now, that, I know where that comes from in the scripture. It's after Abram came back from the, you know, and offered up the to Melchizedek and so forth, but God spoke that to me personally. That's what he does. And so another place, years and years ago, I hadn't been saved more than, a month or so. And I was in the back of the house praying. It's when we were down in East Texas. And in fact, I was in my daughter's room because she, her and Sally were somewhere. But that was a spot where I could go and not be disturbed. If anybody came and went, they wouldn't come back there. So anyway, I was there praying. And the Lord spoke to me and he said, Isaiah 54. Now, honest to God, I didn't even know there was an Isaiah in the Bible, let alone in Isaiah 54. That's how limited my knowledge of the Bible was. But I heard it almost like an audible voice. So I went through and lo and behold, God was right. There is an Isaiah 54. And I read it, and that has been a life scripture for me ever since. Now, I got to say, I didn't understand it, and to this day, I haven't totally understood what it was that God was trying to tell me. But I'm learning more and more now, after 30-some years, what God was trying to tell me clear back then. But I couldn't hear it because I didn't have enough revelation and information, even at that point, to understand how it was applicable to me. Another place God spoke to me and said that I've given you the ministry of reconciliation. I thought, well, isn't that everybody? I mean, doesn't everybody have that? But see, I didn't even know what reconciliation was. I'm just now beginning to understand what he was really trying to tell me. And that is, be ye reconciled.
Yes.
Right? How? There's only one way. We are reconciled to God through the blood of Jesus Christ, through the sacrifice of Jesus.
Yes.
That's our ministry.
Yes.
Not teaching them how to do all the right stuff and become a part of the right club and a member in the right thing, but the blood of Jesus will cleanse them from all unrighteousness.
Yes.
That's reconciliation. Yes. We need to bring people back to God, and they don't want to come back to a God that they're afraid of. So we need to know Isaiah 54 before we can ever even understand what reconciliation really is.
Come on.
Amen. He shall see the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Now that's Isaiah 53. So John chapter 19, verse 30. You don't have to go there, Sheila. It's the scripture where everybody knows. He's on the cross. Jesus says, it is finished. And he gave up the ghost.
Yes.
Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. It is finished. What is finished? The demand for our perfection. The demand for us to keep the law in order to have reconciliation with God. All right. The system of God relating to us on the basis of performance is over. It is over. Once the Messiah's mission was accomplished, here's what Isaiah prophesied and what God has been speaking to me about again after all these years. Isaiah 54, verses 9 and 10. We could go through that whole chapter line upon line, but I'm not going to for the sake of time. I'll just focus on this one part that I can connect here. This is as the waters of Noah unto me. This is God speaking. Speaking to you. Speaking to me. That's how I read it. For as I have sworn that the waters of Noah should no more go over the earth, so have I sworn that I would not be wroth with you, nor rebuke you. the mountains shall depart, the hills be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from you, neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, saith the Lord that has mercy on you.
Amen.
Praise God. Now, I don't know about you, but that's a very comforting scripture. In fact, that whole chapter is very comforting to me because I have blown it. I've missed it. I've misunderstood God. I've not understood half of what God has tried to tell me over the years. And I've stepped backwards, and I've gone this way and that way. And you know, from a Christian perspective, some would say, well, he backslid. He's, you know, what is he doing? You know, he doesn't know what. But God's affection for me, God's acceptance of me has never changed, and it can't, or he'd be a liar.
Right.
He said, I've sworn that just like the waters of Noah, there'll never be another flood that'll end the world. Never.
Right.
Because God promised that he wouldn't do it. That's why the rainbows, you know, whole thing. Go over the earth. So just like that promise to all of humanity, but to Noah specifically.
Right.
So have I sworn that I would not be angry with you, or my wrath will never come against you, nor rebuke you.
Come on.
How many, you know, he doesn't even rebuke me. For the mountains will depart, the hills will be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from you. Neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, saith the Lord that has mercy on you. Praise God. So the love for us is like the promise that God made to Noah. And the covenant with Noah is unique in that it was considered to be one-sided. It was based on God's faithfulness. So much so that God says he'll never be angry with us again. Now, I've got a funny feeling, I don't know because I wasn't there, but I got a pretty good feeling that things are just about as screwed up now as far as the human race is concerned as it was when Noah was here. How many of you think maybe that's a possibility? It's just going nuts, right? But God's not going to do what he did because of what Jesus has done, because of what he's done in Christ. God says he'll never be angry with us again. See, for centuries, religion has been telling people about the anger and the wrath of God, the power of God, the boogeyman under the bed, in the closet, in the dark, anywhere where you can't see and aren't sure. But he himself states that because of the suffering of Jesus, his wrath has been satisfied, and he will remember no more. He will never remove his covenant of peace from us. You can be in turmoil. You can have chaos and still be in peace. I was still at peace. Honestly, did I freak out? I was wondering if it was big enough to keep. After all, I was bait. But I'm just saying, you can be going through things that are very disturbing, that are very uncomfortable, even frightening, but you can still be at peace because of the promise. Crap's happening, but it ain't coming from God. In this world, you will have tribulation. But be of good cheer. I've overcome it.
Yes.
Amen. God is not mad at you. In fact, God is mad about you.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Put that on your refrigerator. Remind yourself every day. Look at that in the mirror on the bathroom wall. Amen. Hebrews chapter 5, verses 11 through 13. And I'll show you, God didn't change, you know, when we come to the new covenant. God's the same ever, forever, yesterday, today, and forever. God has always been a God of love. God has always been the God of grace.
Yes.
But under the covenant, he was bound by that covenant to operate within the confines of that covenant.
Uh-huh.
That's been done away with.
Right.
We are under a new covenant. And it is established in grace, in the love of God. Amen. Of whom we have many things to say and hard to be uttered, seeing you are dull of hearing. For when, for the time you ought to be teachers, you have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. For everyone that uses milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he's a babe. We thought, and in fact we've been taught, that, you know, we're on the meat. The meat is, you know, like hard to swallow, right? So we're on meat because God is really angry and he's going to get you if you don't get your act together. And this is the meat of the word. It's the power of the word. No, it's not. Because a person that is living that way and living under that impression, amen, have missed out on the first principles, the very basic truth of who God is and what God wants to accomplish. Amen? And become such as have need of milk and not of strong bread. Why? They're at a point where they ought to be teaching. They know enough of the Bible they should be teaching, but they don't know what they know. So they still have to be taught. Praise the Lord. For everyone that uses milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness. What's the word of righteousness? You have been made righteous. You are the righteousness of God in Christ. If you don't understand that, you're still dealing with pablum. You're still in the bottle stage. I don't care. It doesn't matter how long you've been saved. Right? I mean, because you can, like I said from the very beginning, you can have all go all through college. You can have a master's degree, a doctor's degree, and still be dumb as a brick when it comes to actually applying that in any way other than going out and trying to teach somebody else what you know but can't experience.
Right.
Exactly. Praise God. All right, let me show you something here. Let's go to Luke chapter 1. And this is going to be a little lengthy here, but it won't take long once we get started. I just want to read the scriptures because most of you are familiar with this story, but I want to make sure that everybody here understands what I'm talking about, okay? So this is Luke chapter 1, and this is about the birth, leading up to the birth of John the Baptist, the forerunner of grace. Amen? So of whom we have many things to say and hardly, okay, we're not there yet. I'm sorry. Luke chapter 1, verse 5 through 20, and then we'll just bounce around a little. So there was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, a certain priest named Zacharias of the course of Abia, and his wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. So they've got some Jewish genealogy here going on. So the priest is Zacharias, and he is John's father, or Shelby. And her name was Elizabeth. And they were both righteous before God, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of the Lord, blameless. So they did all the sacrificial stuff that they were supposed to do. They did everything according to the law. And based on that, they were accepted, okay? And they had no child because that Elizabeth was barren. And they both were now well stricken in years. And it came to pass that while he executed the priest's office before God in the order of his course, according to the custom of the priest's office, his lot was to burn incense when he went into the temple of the Lord. This is Zacharias we're talking about. And the whole multitude of the people were praying without at the time of incense. And there appeared unto him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And when Zacharias saw him, he was troubled, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said unto him, Fear not, Zacharias, for thy prayer is heard, and thy wife Elizabeth shall bear thee a son, and thou shalt call his name John. And thou shalt have joy and gladness, and many shall rejoice at his birth. For he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall drink neither wine nor strong drink, and he shall be filled with the Holy Ghost, even from his mother's womb. And many of the children of Israel shall he turn to the Lord their God. And he shall go before him in the spirit and the power of Elias to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. And Zacharias said unto the angel, Whereby shall I know this? For I am an old man and my wife well stricken in years. And the angel answering said unto him, I am Gabriel. that stand in the presence of God and am sent to speak unto thee and to shew thee these glad tidings. And behold, thou shalt be dumb and not able to speak until the day that these things shall be performed, because thou believest not my words, which shall be fulfilled in their season." All right? Now, skip down to verse 24. "And after those days, his wife Elizabeth conceived and hid herself 5 months, saying..." That's okay, we don't need it. Go on, just go to 59 and through 64, same chapter. "And it came to pass that on the eighth day they came to circumcise the child, and they called him Zacharias after the name of his father." Remember, he can't talk. So they assume immediately that because it's the firstborn son, he'll be named after the father, which was the tradition. It was the way it was always done, right? "So they came to circumcise the child. They called him Zacharias after the name of his father. And his mother answered and said, 'Not so, but he shall be called John.'" Praise the Lord.
Uh-huh.
"And they said unto her, 'There is none of thy kindred that is called by his name.' And they made signs to his father how he would have him called. And he asked for a writing table, and wrote, saying, 'His name is John.' And they marveled all. And his mouth was opened immediately, and his tongue loosed, and he spake, and he praised God." Okay, verse 77 through 79. I'm jumping around. I just want you to have this in your head. Okay? "So, to give knowledge of salvation unto his people by the remission of their sins through the tender mercy of our God, thereby the day spring from on high hath visited us to give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the way of peace." Praise the Lord. All right. Here's what I want you to consider. How the old covenant and the law is illustrated through this story of John the Baptist. See, there's nothing by accident. Every word in this scripture, in the Bible, is there to edify, is to build up, is to give instruction in righteousness.
Yes.
To identify us.
Uh-huh.
Amen?
Amen?
So, look at 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 7 and 8. Just a couple scriptures here, and then I'll get in to try to make some sense out of that. Okay? 1 Corinthians 2, verse 7 and 8. "But we speak the wisdom of God in the mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory." Amen? All right, back to Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1 again. We know it's types and shadows, the law, and so forth. This is what he's telling us. "For the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the comers thereunto perfect." All right, so the law carried God's secret wisdom, but it did it in types and shadows, because it was unable to reveal the fullness of the gospel until the proper time. So it was done in types and shadows for a purpose, because the time hadn't come for it to be revealed.
Right.
Satan's still trying to figure this stuff out. They didn't get it because it was not revealed. Amen? Zacharias was silenced because of unbelief. And he was unable to speak the full revelation that the angel had given him. And he was forced to rely on making signs to communicate the truth. Under the law, our sins are remembered, and judgment is rendered. You know, Zechariah's name means "the Lord remembers."
Hmm.
Our performance and religious works are not enough to produce life. Zechariah, Elizabeth were as religious as they could be, but they were barren.
Right.
They could not produce life. Galatians 3, verse 23. You want to know why we don't see revival? We see lots of stuff, but I'm not so sure it's all revival. Because where the law is, there's no life.
Exactly.
It brings death.
Right, yeah.
But before faith came, we were kept under the law, shut up under the faith which should afterwards be revealed. So before the law, before faith came, we were kept under the law, we were shut up unto the faith which should afterwards be revealed. Elizabeth, and we read it, remained in seclusion for 5 months of her pregnancy until she began to show. Till it was visible. Till you could see it. Amen? The law was engraved on stone tablets. Zacharias could only communicate by writing on tablets. Isaiah said John would be the forerunner to the Messiah, the one who would show the way. What? What was the way? Repent. Change your mind about God. He's not angry. He's not mad. He loves. He's grace. He wants to save you. He wants to love you. He wants you to experience him. Change your mind about God, because the kingdom has come near. Jesus is now here on the planet. That was John's message. Zacharias and Elizabeth are both pictures of the law. But guess what? They gave birth to grace.
Yes. Thank you, Lord.
In the person of John. The name John is special in that it was the actual way it would have been written out in Hebrew would have been Yohanan, which is a variation of the word Yahweh, which means God is gracious. God came to parents that were vested in the tradition and the religious heritage of the law, and he told them, name your son, God is gracious.
That's good.
See, this isn't about a new birth. It's about a transformation. New birth just sets the stage for it.
Thank you, Lord.
Without being born again, you can't experience the transformation. But I will say this, you can be born again and still not experience the transformation.
Amen.
Isaiah chapter 40, verses 1 through 3. You know, if we really grasp this, really get a revelation of it, not just information, it will do exactly what Jesus said it would do. It will set you free.
Hallelujah.
Free to love yourself. Free to love God. Free to love others. Free to not judge. Free to just leave it to God to deal with it all. Just love Him. Because in this room, and this is not, I'm not asking everybody to look around and do your own measuring here. We're not about measuring ourselves among ourselves. I'm just saying, but within this room, in any room, any group of people, you'll find varying levels of revelation. It's just the way it is. It doesn't make one person better or smarter or anything else. It just means we come through life and we experience life in different ways. And so it takes, some are going to get some revelation about things quicker than others. Others will get other revelation. And that's why we got to have a body. That's why we got to come together. Your revelation may be critical to me ever getting past the only revelation I may have.
Exactly.
I can't experience everything.
Right.
And neither can you. That's why we got to have other people, amen, interacting.
Right.
They tell us what God is saying in their life, what God is doing in their heart, and what God is doing in their life. It's God. It's the God in them that's trying to give you revelation. And we can be so stupid as to just ignore it because either we don't know the person or we don't have a great deal of respect for him for whatever reason or the other. Man, don't do that. somebody offers you revelation, you grab it with both arms and hug it and hold it tight. And if it turns out to be anything other than that, let it go. But if it isn't, you're going to miss the opportunity to hear God. And believe me, his voice changes. Sometimes it sounds like mine. Other times it sounds nothing like me. It sounds like somebody else. A couple of times it sounded like my wife. I had to really rethink that. Praise the Lord. Comfort ye, my people, saith your God. Speak ye comfortably to Jerusalem and cry unto her that her warfare is accomplished. Her iniquity is pardoned. For she has received of the Lord's hand double for all her sins. The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. That's what, that's John.
There it is.
Praise God. The law existed to serve and bring about grace. Just like a mother carries and births a child. The law wasn't against grace any more than Zacharias and Elizabeth were hostile to John. That's why you see Paul talking about the law is not evil. I mean, it's holy. It's pure. Right?
Yes.
For the purpose it was created for.
Right.
To establish the context in which God could come and reveal the totality of his love and his grace and his goodness and his mercy. For that reason, we ought to thank God for the law. But once it served his purpose, let it go.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Zacharias and Elizabeth weren't angry with John. They weren't hostile with John. Instead, the law, it says, rejoiced and welcomed grace into the world.
Yes.
Yes.
Man. Where did we miss this? The people that fight against what I'm talking about here this morning ought to be rejoicing that what they have been believing and teaching has brought them to a place where they can be set free and experience God in his totality as far as the human can. To know his love, to know his mercy, to know his grace, to know his goodness, to know that his power is for you and not against you.
Amen.
Praise God. Deuteronomy chapter 31, verses 1 through 8. We're about done here. After all, it's been 2 weeks, so only a couple minutes past noon. Imagine what it's been like for Sally. No break. 24/7, I was there all the time. Except, of course, when the fish had me. And Moses went and spake these words unto all Israel. And he said unto them, I am 120 years old this day. I can no more go out and come in. Also the Lord has said unto me, thou shalt not go over the Jordan. The Lord thy God, he will go over before thee, and he will destroy these nations from before thee, and thou shalt possess them. And Joshua, he shall go over before thee, as the Lord has said. And the Lord shall do unto them as he did to Zion and to Og, kings of the Amorites, and unto the land of them whom he destroyed. And the Lord shall give them up before your face, that ye may do unto them according unto all the commandments which I have commanded you. Be strong and of good courage. Fear not, nor be afraid of them. For the Lord thy God, he it is that doeth, that doth go with thee, and he will not fail thee, nor forsake thee. And Moses called unto Joshua and said unto him in the sight of all Israel, be strong and of a good courage, for thou must go with this people unto the land which the Lord hath sworn unto their fathers to give them, and thou shalt cause them to inherit it. And the Lord, he it is that doeth, that doth go before thee, and he will be with thee. He will not fail thee, neither forsake thee. Fear not, neither be dismayed. Praise the Lord. So the thing to understand here is that Moses, obviously, Moses never entered the promised land. Moses was the embodiment of the law. That's why it's called the Mosaic Law. Amen? So like Moses, the law was only able to lead us to the edge of the promised land. To the kingdom. To the edge of the kingdom, but not into the kingdom.
That's right.
It's incapable of leading us into our inheritance. That's why the mixture is what creates, in my mind and my understanding, is what creates the inconsistencies in terms of the miraculous operating in our lives. You understand what I'm saying? I'm not, first of all, this isn't just a, you know, like forever Disneyland for everybody. There's junk happens. There is life that comes along and messes with our plans. But God is with us. He is for us. Amen. But we have to understand that unless we operate in agreement with God's plan and His purpose, then it's no wonder we don't have the consistency that we see in the Bible that should be ours. Because the moment you go back under the law, you have fallen from grace.
Exactly.
These things come by grace. They don't come by our effort.
Right.
It's what he just told him. You're going to go in. I'm not going because of the law. He didn't say that, but that's the metaphor here that we're seeing. And so what happens is he tells him, you're going to go, but don't worry about it because God is going to win the battle for you.
Right.
He's going to fight the battle. He'll be there with you. He'll never leave you. He'll forsake. There'll be battles. But he'll be there to get you through the battle. He'll see to it that you are victorious.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
So for us to enter into the kingdom, we've already talked about the kingdom. In the kingdom, everything is accomplished.
Uh-huh.
It's already done. Right?
Yep.
Healing's already happened.
Yep.
Prosperity's already taken place. Right? Deliverance. All of it. It's already done in the kingdom.
Yes.
So for us to enter in and take possession, the law has got to be left behind.
Uh-huh.
Galatians 4, verses 27 through 30. These will be the last scriptures.
Four what?
27. Lord, it is written, rejoice, thou barren that bearest not. Break forth and cry, thou that travailest not. For the desolate hath many more children than she which hath a husband. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. But as then, he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the spirit, even so it is now. Nevertheless, what saith the scripture? Cast out the bondwoman, the law, and her son. For the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman.
There you go.
Praise God.
Cool.
It's only one way to get the inheritance.
Mm-hmm.
It's born from above.
Yes.
From Israel. You know, from the free.
Yes.
Praise God.
Thank you,
Lord. So the question is the same as it's always been. Religion may look and even sound spiritual at times, but a lot of it is just the flesh.
Yes.
Amen.
That knows what the flesh looks like, so tries to make it spiritual.
Amen.
You know, I this is not to be, you know, critical or judgmental or anything, but because, man, I came from about as Pentecostal background as you can get. Gifts of spirit. You know, I'm talking about the way I was born again, the environment that we were in for years. And I'm just saying, a lot of that was not God. I'm sorry. You know, it was people responding to God. And then it forced people to do things that they really didn't feel led to do. They just saw that everybody else did it, and if they didn't do it, then they wouldn't get to be in their group. So lots of behaviors that had really nothing to do with the spirit other than people's reaction to it. Now, I'm not saying that's wrong, except this is the problem. Suppose you're an unbeliever and you walk into one of these. I'm tell you what my mother-in-law said. My God, what will they do next? She was a good Christian. She just wasn't Pentecostal. Praise the Lord. And so what happens then is we begin to measure ourselves by how high we jump, how fast we run, how quickly we fall. All of that can be true. I mean, it can actually happen. I'm just saying, the problem with that is it draws our attention to that thing rather than to the Spirit, which is trying to deal with us. It's trying to lead us. Because when I see Jesus and I see the disciples, I don't see any of that. So what happened that changed all of it? What made that happen? What caused that, these manifestations that you don't see in the Bible? Praise the Lord. Okay, that's a rhetorical question, but I'll wait a while just to see. I'm just saying this. I'm not against manifestations, physical manifestations. I'm just saying, let's not confuse them with something that they're not. We can have the most powerful move of God here that anyone has ever experienced without anybody acting any different than what you would if you were sitting at the kitchen table with the neighbor having to come up. We get excited. I get excited. And we respond. But that's us responding.
Sure.
It's not God moving. And the problem with that is because then we're always waiting for somebody to respond in order that we can validate the fact that God is there and that he's moving. God will never leave us or forsake us. He's here all the time. He's here to do what only God can do if we will believe that his goodness towards us is wanting to manifest.
Yes. Yes.
Praise God. So what we continue to hold on to, traditional thinking and misplaced blame and shame and condemnation. You see, that's just the opposite end of that, or the opposite side of that coin. I'm just such a jerk. I'm just so no good. And don't anybody say amen, because I'm just no good. And, but I'm just, you know, I'm such a failure, and I've screwed up so bad, and I missed that, and I should have done this, and I didn't, and I got mad, and I lost it, and I did all that. Okay, that's one thing. That's a lie, right? Do we not know that that is not true based on what we've already been reading here, that God will never be angry with me, he finds me perfect, I'm righteous in him, and so on and so forth, as long as I'm in Christ, right? Well, the other side of that coin is, oh, I'm the man of power for the new millennium, and hallelujah, look out, here I come, and woo, praise God, Now, on the one hand, this is true. What I said is true in terms of the natural.
Yeah.
But it's not true in the kingdom. It's not true as far as God is concerned. So therefore, it's not true. It may be a fact, but it's not the truth.
Right. Come
on. And the same thing is true the other side of that coin, where I'm doing all of this. Now, yes, it's true. I'm feeling something. But what I'm feeling and then how I'm expressing those feelings are, they may be a fact that I'm feeling God, but it's not the truth of how God operates.
Come on.
Jesus never freaked anybody out. They were attracted to him.
Yeah.
He didn't spook them. He didn't cause them to be uncomfortable. And oh my God, what is he going to do next? As my mother-in-law said. He was real. Just sincere. I'm not coming again. Look, I've said this before. I get goosebumps. But I get goosebumps when I hear the Marine Corps hymn. I'm saying the Star Spangled Banner. That doesn't make it God. It just means I'm reacting emotionally to something that I connect with. There's times when I'll, you know, God will be, God's kind of talking to me or dealing with me through the different things that are going on in the service. I'll get up here, and I can't hardly talk as I'm in tears almost. My voice breaks. I feel like a little teenage girl, you know. It's embarrassing. But it's me reacting to God's love and to God's presence and to know that he's concerned about what I'm concerned about.
Yeah.
It isn't God. It's me responding to the presence of God. I don't have to be embarrassed about it any more than anybody has to be embarrassed about leaping and shouting and that. I'm just saying, let's know what it is. So that when we're dealing with people, we can use wisdom. Because that person who doesn't know God probably is going to think you are a complete nutcase if you start jumping up and down and jerking and screaming at them because you're excited. And they're going to think, so that's how God is. Weird. How many of you know you can do stuff with family that you don't do with everybody? You don't want to come to my house unannounced, okay? Because we do stuff we don't do anywhere else, you know? You know what I'm saying? So, just being honest. Because we're okay with it, right? I mean, it's us. We're family. Same way in church. We get close to one another. You know, we understand. We get the, you know, the kind of the spiritual influences and so on and so forth. So we're not worried about it. We're happy with it. We're good with it. Somebody's getting a blessing. We know that's what we say. That's good. Good. I'm glad they're being blessed. I'm being blessed because they're getting blessed. Right?
Yep.
But I'm not going to do it at Walmart.
Right.
You know, no way. Unless I'm paying cash. Get out of there, you know? Am I making sense to you? I'm not trying to be critical or hateful or anything. I'm just saying we know these things to be true, and we just need to... Let's let God be God.
Yes.
And we'll just, you know,
amen.
Let's trust him. Let's know that he loves us, that he's for us, that he's not going to do anything that is not going to be to our benefit. Yes. Stuff will happen.
Yeah.
We all here, I'm looking around, I see it, you know, so you're not little kids.
Right.
That's as far as I'll go with it. But, you know, we've all lived life. So we know that stuff happens. To say otherwise is just, it's a lie. It's not true.
Right.
But God will be with us
yes.
to see us through
yes.
it.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
And that's where his love comes in.
Amen.
That love that we know will not fail gives us the strength to look at the situation and say, there's light at the tunnel. There's
yeah.
another way past this. There's a way that God's going to get me through it. I may not understand it today. It may be so painful I can't even talk about it. But if I know the Calvary's coming, you know, like if I know that God is with me, I'm not going to fail. It may look like failure, but it's only because I can only see this much of it right now.
Right.
But you cannot fail.
Right.
Amen.
He will not let you fail. He's victorious in every area.
Yes.
And in him, we are more than conquerors.
Yes, Lord.
Praise God.
Yes, Lord.
We're going to continue to hold on to doctrines of convenience instead of trusting God to let him out of the box and get us out at the same time. We have these false images of God. And because of that, it causes us to question his intentions for good toward us.
Amen.
You really know him. You'll know he can do nothing but love you.
Yes.
And any act that you experience in your life, if you can connect it with God, I promise you, regardless of what it might seem like at the moment, it's an act of love.
There you go.
It's God showing how much he loves you. The choice is ours. Choose life. Choose the gospel. that choice, you have the kingdom.
Amen.
And all that goes with it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. God is love.
Yes.
A love like no other. But a love that he wants us to experience to such a degree that it flows from us. That it just rolls out of us.
Yes.
Without us having to sit down and think up a plan and figure out how we're going to love somebody. It just comes.
Yes.
Our cup runneth over with love.
Yes.
Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Give him a hand clap this morning. Praise God. Amen, amen. God bless you. Amen. Go in the love of the Lord. And thank you for your patience and for listening to my dribble. You know, the areas that were not about God, my stuff, okay? So God is good, and he loves you beyond your imagination. But dream big, because you'll never outdream his love. Praise God. God bless you. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.